Hey everyone, welcome back to The Fin Factor. I'm Paul.
And I'm Aaron.
And this is episode number 52.
52, let's see. Craig Rivet, a lot of people did not like.
Yeah.
Matt Irwin, and Lucas Radil, who we'll probably see this year a lot more.
Yeah, I like the Matt Irwin call there. He was one of my favorites. I forgot what they call him, something bomber.
But he had a huge shot.
Huge shot from the point. Anyway, so this episode, we're going to be talking about the $1 million LeBanc contract, along with some of the forward holes that we're going to be seeing and the defensive pairings.
Yep, and we'll talk about hopefully the power play strategy that will change without a Pavelski tipping in pucks anymore. And we have a fantasy hockey league that we're going to start taking signups for, as well as starting a new EASHL team on NHL 20 when that comes out.
You got it out. Congratulations on that one.
It's hard.
Yeah. Cool. All right, you ready to start the show?
Ready.
Why are you smiling like that? What are you doing? I don't get it. Did you change your hair?
Yes.
Okay.
It's my hair.
All right, good. For those of you who are watching and not listening on the podcast, Aaron got the braces off.
Yeah, and for those of you listening to the podcast, hopefully I speak a little more clearly than I did before. Probably not, but we'll see.
Yeah, I think we stumbled a little in the opener there, but that's okay.
Right.
Mulligan.
Good start, yeah.
Very good. Okay, so first topic of discussion. Kevin LeBanc signed a one-year, $1 million contract, and a lot of people were saying that, you know, Doug Wilson fleeced him. And a lot of just fan confusion, I think. Some folks didn't really understand why Kevin LeBanc would sign a one-year, $1 million contract and why they're saying that because agents should be fired, right?
So, right, yeah. I think what Kevin LeBanc is doing here is he's betting on himself. He knew that there wasn't much cap space to go around. He didn't want to kind of get a bridge deal for 2 years, maybe 3 years, for $3 million when he thinks that he could probably make four or five. Maybe even six, if he has one good year or another good year. He also didn't have arbitration rights, so he was pretty much stuck with whatever the Sharks are going to offer him. And the only leverage that he would have is to sit out the season, and if he didn't sign by December 1st, then he'd have to sit out the entire year. We saw Nylander do this in Toronto last year. He signed at the 11th hour, right before that December 1st deadline. So it never really ends well for either the player nor the team if you sit out that long. So LeBanc, pretty much him and his agent sat down and said, okay, Kevin said, I'm going to be a much better player. He's going to be thrust into a top six role now, so he's going to get better minutes. He thinks that he can play better. We saw him have a very good second half of the season. The first half did not go so well. It wasn't terrible, but it wasn't consistent and it wasn't good. His 200-foot game was what the problem was. His offense has never really been the problem, you know, outside of having some droughts here and there, but his offense we know is good. It's the 200-foot game that he learned as he played that he needs to shore up those mistakes and not make as many in the back end. Once he started doing that, his ice time started going up, and this happened right around the All-Star break last year. That second half of the season, he started playing really well, and in the playoffs, we saw him get all 4 points on that power play, that one power play against Vegas. So we know that it's there. I think he's looking for a bounce back season. Let's say he has a good year. He got 50 points last year. Let's say he bumps that to 60, even close to 70 points with more ice time, more power play time. Then he's looking to get paid almost like Timo Meier did, where he's getting a bridge deal of 3 to 4 years at $5-6 million. And now that there's going to be more cap space next year, the Sharks are going to be able to do it, and because he kind of did the Sharks a solid by doing $1 million this year, I'm sure there's kind of a little wink, you know, wink, wink, nudge, nudge deal going on with Doug Wilson and him. So I don't think Doug Wilson's going to leave him high and dry. He is still an RFA next year, but I think he's going to get paid next year. He's betting on himself playing really well this year.
Yeah, and that's just it, right? When you have the opportunity to get yourself off of the third line role and get those minutes and be able to jump in a top six role, right? Especially because, you know, we've lost guys like Pavelski, Nyquist, Donskoy. So there's winger spots that are open and available at the higher levels there. So he's going to get more ice time, as Aaron just said. He's going to get still his power play time because Pete DeBoer calls him elite on the power play. But he's going to be able to go and play with guys like, you know, a Logan Couture or a Tomas Hertl, right? These guys that are prolific at getting the puck in the back of the net here. So, or they are going to be even better as the seasons progress. So, I think Kevin LeBanc's made a pretty good move for himself and for the organization. Obviously, very team friendly. But like you said, betting on himself, right? So, you give yourself that 1 year to prove yourself that you're up there in the top six. And, you know, if you, like you said, if he does get 60, 70 points, he's looking for a much bigger pay raise than if he just taken, you know, 2-3 years at $3 million or whatever, right? So, good for everybody all around. It's kind of nice to see that it worked out, you know, the way that it did, really. Yeah. So,
especially this season with not a lot of cap space to go around.
Yeah. Absolutely. So, as we just said, we had some guys exit, obviously. Pavelski, Nyquist, Donskoy being the biggest names in the forward core, right? So, LeBanc is going to be moving up into a top six role, which is great for him. But that does leave some holes in the forward position. So, what we were looking at was possible scenarios of guys stepping in and being able to take some time on those lines. And for me, I was going to talk about some of the prospects. Obviously, the same usual suspects that we've been talking about on this show. Chmielewski, Chekovic, Alex True, who had a great year with the Barracuda. And he's got the body to play in the NHL, I think. He's a big kid, right? So these are guys that I think, you know, skill level-wise and just physically for True, he's a bigger guy. I think these guys could step in potentially. Maybe not in the top six, but definitely filling in where LeBanc was, where he had moved up. That spot might be open and available for a younger prospect who's got a really good camp ahead of him here. So something to look at. We have some depth, it looks like, at the winger position that we can slot somebody in.
I think there's going to be some competition there because there's going to be some open spots. Maybe we see some of those guys kind of rotate around, maybe based on matchups, based on who's kind of the hot hand at the time. And who gets rotated around. So a lot of times what we see now are teams, they like to do pairings even in the forward positions. So they keep two together. So let's say, who is it? I can't even think right now. Timo Meier and
Couture
kind of stick together, right? And then you have...
Hertl and Kane,
right?
Say.
Those two stick together, and then their other winger kind of rotates around.
Yeah.
We see teams do a lot of that. I think we kind of see DeBoer kind of do that because his lines get thrown into the blender all the time throughout the entire season. So I wouldn't be surprised if we see a lot of that happening. The other option is going to the free agency. And without a lot of cap space to spend, let's assume that they are going to sign Jumbo. Let's assume they are going to sign Patty, which we'll get into in a minute.
Yeah. But,
then you don't have a whole lot of money to go around for another top six winger. Some of the names that we kind of looked at the list are Jason Pominville, Justin Williams, Thomas Vanek, and even Patrick Maroon.
Right.
Some of these guys, I can see maybe one or two of them being more likely than the other ones. I don't know. It's kind of hard.
Fits.
Yeah, in a way. Patrick Maroon, I just don't think he would be a good fit. I don't think he's a top six person. I think he's more of a third line kind of type player. Maybe if Patrick Marleau doesn't sign, they would go after him. And then Vanek is kind of on the tail end of his career.
Yeah.
Justin Williams had a really good year. He was in Carolina. He helped them get everything together last year in their incredible run in the playoffs, getting to the playoffs too. So maybe a one-year deal type thing. And then Pominville, kind of the same thing. Like, I just don't know if they'd be able to afford him.
Yeah.
So it's, to me, the free agency isn't super realistic. I think what the Sharks are going to do is really wait until training camp. Maybe offer those guys, if they don't have a contract at that point, an offer or a tryout.
Sure.
Maybe, just to kind of see if they can fit in. Maybe we'll see kind of something like that happen, but we'll know in the coming weeks or even in the next month if anything happens.
Yeah, and we had talked about, let's assume that Jumbo gets signed. Let's assume that Patty gets signed, right? So that right there is, like you said, almost an entire line of free agents. And if that's the league minimum that we're able to sign these guys to, I mean, maybe not Jumbo. Jumbo might take a little bit more than the million, but Patty's already getting paid his $6 million right through the buyout. So he'd be, you know, a $1 million candidate in my eyes, right? He wants any more than that. That's just greed at that point. So I don't think he'd be asking for much more than that, especially from the Sharks. He wants to go to the play with the Sharks. So I can see those guys filling in on that line there. One of the things that we got even during the live actually was how come we haven't seen this signing happen yet, right? It's we had talked about in the previous episode, right? We had Erik Karlsson signing. Once that gets done, you know, we know that Pavs is not going to be able to come back after that, right? Mm-hmm. Unless he takes like a ridiculously team-friendly deal. So the next domino to fall was going to be LeBanc. LeBanc's domino fell. And I felt like right after that, you would see, okay, the rest of the guys get signed. Jumbo, probably Patty, right? But we haven't seen it yet. And there was some concern during the live, you know, how come we haven't seen this yet? Should we be concerned that Jumbo's not part of the team? And my answer to that was no. You know, I don't think that that's a concern just yet. I feel like for me, my whole reasoning behind Jumbo not being signed yet is because they're not sure what they're going to end up paying Joe. And again, for me, my speculation is that there's might be something else in the works with Doug Wilson right now. If he's thinking about maybe trying to acquire somebody else or making a trade or some sort, whatever player you're getting, because there might be different players that you're talking about or different teams that you're talking about with different players, that player could make a little bit more or a little bit less if you pay Jumbo ahead of time, because you know he's going to take whatever's left.
Right.
At this point in his career, Jumbo's saying, I'll just take whatever's left. There's enough money to go around. Don't worry about it. So whoever that is that they're considering bringing in, that would adjust the price for what they're going to end up paying Joe. I don't know. I don't think that they're necessarily going to be making a trade. I think that prospects are the right call here. But if there is a trade in the works, I have to imagine it involves Aaron Dell. And I think what you're going to see here is...
Why?
The reason why is because I think he's just too replaceable. I don't think that Dell's a bad goalie by any means. I know his numbers were bad, but so were Jones. And I think, that, again, that's a reflection of the team's defense in front of them of last season. I think this season we're going to be in a much better spot. We'll talk a little bit more about that later. But I think Dell is probably the most replaceable guy on the team, right? You've got a backup goaltender who doesn't play that many games. Martin Jones likes to soak up more games, and they like giving him more games. And he didn't really have a great season. I think Bebo could jump in from the AHL level, go ahead and just take the reins as the backup and do pretty much the same job that Dell's done. Again, I have no problem with Dell. I just think that Bebo could basically do the same thing. He's cheaper.
Yeah, I think when
it makes sense.
When they signed Shortridge, I think a couple months ago, right? Mm-hmm. I think that kind of made the Sharks, their depth in goaltending is incredible right now, and I think it's kind of a logjam.
Yeah,
I think moving Dell, moving up Bebo, moving up those guys up the chain is a good thing. So, and Dell's making quite a chunk of change for a backup goalie that's not playing so well.
Right.
So maybe we see him getting traded to a team that has the cap space or needs a backup goalie. He's a decent backup goalie, and just eating it and giving a 7th round draft pick in return, something, right? Something that's not very expensive. Or the Sharks are going to have to pair him up with a top-end prospect to get rid of that contract, which hopefully is not the case. I could see the Sharks sending a draft pick as well. Maybe a draft pick, like a 3rd round draft pick, Aaron Dell for a 6th round draft pick or something, or 5th round. Who knows? I'm not really playing GM right now, but that's my what I would see how it would what it would take to move Aaron Dell off the team.
Sure.
And then that shores up some cash, so we have a little bit more cap space. Some other things that I've seen people float around, which I think is a little bit more realistic, is kind of just starting the season with these prospects, with the holes, trying to fill it with what they have, and then later in the season going to the trade deadline, depending on where the Sharks are, how they're doing, who is available, what teams are tanking, what teams are selling. You know, some players might be available that you didn't think about right now.
Right.
We didn't even think about. So I could see that scenario happening more likely than going to free agency.
Sure. And one other thing that I don't know if we talked about it beforehand or not, but, you know, if Dell does get traded and he's paired up with a prospect, that might be, you know, where we get like this top 9 player, right, for that right wing hole, because we have 2 right wing holes to fill. We have a top 6 and we have a top 9, really, is what it comes down to. So that might be something that we look at, right? We might see a trade happening to make that happen. Now, again, the only reason we're talking about this is if we go back to what we were originally talking about, was Jumbo and why hasn't he signed yet. Well, if all these things are in the works and we don't know exactly what player we'd be getting, because there's maybe a couple different ones that Doug Wilson's gotten on his mind, they're making different amounts. So you don't want to pay Joe $3 million and then get a guy that puts you $1 million over the cap, right? So that, basically, that's what I think is going on here. So I think what'll happen now, because I know previously what we said was you're going to see the rest of the dominoes fall well, Joe's going to sign right after that. I think now I'll change that to, if you see Joe sign, they're done, right? That's what I think is going to happen. Once you see Joe sign his contract, they're done.
He's probably the last guy to sign.
Yes.
Because he's just going to take what's left.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that, I think, is the explanation of why you have not seen that
yet. I also think they're going to announce it the same day.
Patty and Joe? Yeah,
because they're such good friends and they're always tied together.
Yeah.
Ever since they were drafted 1 and 2.
Yeah.
So they're always together. So I think I wouldn't be surprised if, because Patty's isn't going to have a huge contract, so it's not that big of a deal.
Right.
So I think that's what's going to happen. I wouldn't be surprised.
Okay, moving on from forwards, talking about the defensive pairings. Now, the defensive pairings we think are pretty well set, and I think the Sharks are actually going to be a little bit better defensively this year. We talked a little bit about it in the live, but why don't you go ahead and roll through the defensive pairings.
Well, Burns and Schimmick are... That's a lock. That's what's going to happen on that pairing. The next pairing, Carlson, I think they're going to start off with Vlasic and Carlson together. Mm-hmm. They're going to do that again. Last season when they started that way, I think it took about 10 games and they pulled the plug on it. They did go back to it later in the season, though, and it was working. Like, even in the playoffs, it was working. Mm-hmm. You just kind of got to follow the ice time and the money. Like, those guys are getting paid big bucks. Vlasic is not going to be a third-line pairing guy for an entire season, so he's going to get the better look over
Dylan.
So then we have the third pairing is going to be Dylan and a switching off of Heed and
Prout.
So they're both right-handed. Heed and Prout are both right-handed shots. One of those guys is probably going to be scratched every other game, depending on matchups, because Prout's a bigger guy. And he can, you know, if they're playing Vegas or if they're playing LA or Anaheim, the bigger teams, they're going to probably put Prout in. And if they're playing somebody else, they'll put Heat in. So it just kind of depends on the matchups. So I bet those are the two guys that we're going to see scratched almost every game, one or the other.
Right.
And then we have Jacob Middleton's the other guy who is probably the eighth defenseman in a way.
Yeah.
He's kind of the left-handed shot that is if someone gets hurt, Dylan or... I gotta look at the pairings. Schimmick, Vlasic, or Dylan are the three lefties. If any of those guys get hurt, then that's who's gonna step in there. So our defense is pretty solid.
Yeah.
We'll see what starts with Carlson. Like, who's going to pair up with Carlson?
Yeah, and I think, again, for me, I think who will pair up with Carlson is going to be Vlasic. For the ice time reasons, I think those guys get paid enough, and it's not even just the dollar amount, really. I think those types of players are the more elite players at their positions, and they want the ice time. I don't think Vlasic wants to take on third pairing minutes, and when you're not paired with Burns and you're not paired with Carlson, and Burns and Carlson are on different lines, that leaves you as the third pair. So I think Carlson's going to pair up with EK65 just by virtue of them all being, you know, at the top of their games, right? Having said that, I think last season I was more impressed with Dylan and Carlson.
Yes.
I would like to see that pairing work, but again, you can't, not at the at the detriment of time on ice for Mark Edward Vlasic. And so
what I said during the live is we'll see Vlasic will probably have a career year playing with Carlson, just like Dylan had a career year when he played with Carlson for about half a season, right?
And to be fair, Tim Heed playing alongside Vlasic last season, I really like that pair. So all of those pairs, I really like them with all the big three, if we want to call them that, separated. I really do like those pairings where they are, but I just don't think they're going to do that. They're going to stick Vlasic with Carlson. You're probably going to see Heed playing alongside Dylan. And for those games where you're playing against LA or Vegas where they throw Prout in there instead of Heed, you're going to have Prout and Dylan on the same line.
Ooh, I mean, just baby. those guys in the third pairing, if it's Dylan and one of those two guys, they're just not going to have nearly as many minutes.
No.
Because you're going to have Carlson and Vlasic and Burns and Schimmick. Maybe not so much Schimmick, but the other guys, they're going to be over 25 minutes a night. I mean, imagine the other team. You're going to have to face one of those three top defensemen in the league
for all game
long. All game. Like, you just swap them out. It's just ridiculous. Again, just an embarrassment of riches on the blue line. Right
and now. On top of all that, you're going to be looking at a defensive core that is coached by Bob Bugner now.
Right.
Right? So Bob's coming back from He was in San Jose, went to Florida to do a head coaching gig, mm-hmm. and that didn't really pan out for him. He came back to San Jose as the assistant coach, and he's going to be doing for Brent Burns what he did in 2016. Right. I think it was 2016. He's going to be doing that for everybody on the blue line now. So, right. again, I think we're going to be in a much better position. Again, this is something that was brought up during the live, was a concern. Do you think that the D will be worse? Are we worse off because we don't have Justin Braun? Honestly, no. I think we're in a better position because we're healthy now. We got Schimmick back in the fold. We're going to have Eric Carlson back. And I think either way, when you're playing Heed or Prout, right? Right. I mean, we were playing with Joakim Ryan for, 5 minutes a night or whatever it was. I don't think that makes us a better team. So I think this season we're going to have an even better defense than we did when we didn't have a good defense in the first place. Right. But I think we're going to be in a better spot this season. Again, we're going to have healthy players coming right out of the gate. Mm-hmm. Hopefully they can stay healthy. That would be great. But Bob Bugner's really going to come in there and make everybody
and
good.
And Bob was what he was talking about in 2016 is when Burns won the Norris Trophy for the best defenseman. Burns started off as a forward in his career, got switched to defense, kind of bounced back between winger and defense for a couple years, stuck with defense, and I think it's a good move for him. But Bugner really came in there and helped him define his defensive game and get much better. Then he went on to be a head coach of the Florida Panthers for 2.5 seasons and got fired at the end of last season. Mm-hmm. So he came back to San Jose. So he's coming back into that same role that he won, helped Burns turn into a Norris winning trophy.
Norris trophy winning
defenseman.
There you go.
It's late. Sorry.
No, the braces came off and he's, I don't know, guys. Yeah. It's just,
The words just come out quicker than I can think about it. So anyway, the defense is going to get better, and with that, the numbers for both, assuming Dell is still there, Dell and Jones are going to go up or down.
Down.
Depending on how you... save percentage will go up, goals against average will go down.
There you go.
I think the team defense is just going to get better. Everyone knows each other a lot better. Everyone knows Carlson a lot better and how he plays, and he'll be hopefully healthy for the entire season. That's a whole other show.
Yeah, we shall see. Yeah. Moving on from that power play, right? So there was, again, concern during the live. You guys need to check out the lives because we're answering a lot of these questions during the lives and whatnot. And it actually gives us some good ideas for the shows as well when, when we're a little bit lighter. Mm-hmm. So one of the questions that we had during the live was, on the power play, you know, is there concern because Pavs is there? Are we going to be seeing anything like different? Basically we're going to see a power play where we're not shooting to tip the puck necessarily the whole time. Now, I'm not saying our entire strategy is not going to revolve around tipping, but I do think that with Pavs being the elite tipper in the league, probably the best in the league, it was definitely a great strategy to have when the faceoff dropped back to Burns. We all saw Kevin LeBanc always bouncing off the boards to Burnsy whenever he picks up the puck, and then wrist shot from the point, try to tip it in, then crash the net, right? So that's not really going to be the way that we go for it this season. I don't think he's going to shoot to tip. I think he's going to shoot to hit the net. But you think he's not going to be shooting from the same position.
Right. I also think, before that, I think Timo Meier's kind of taken over the Pavelski spot in front of the goal. He's going to be there to clean up the garbage, maybe start tipping the pucks. He's just not going to be as good as Pavelski because nobody's as good as Pavelski. But I think what we're going to see is what we've been talking about for a long time is putting Burns in the Ovechkin office. And what that is when you're looking at the goal that the Sharks are shooting on, the left faceoff circle, kind of the top of that circle, he's going to sit there with he's a right-handed shot, and he's waiting for the one-timer. They're going to work the puck around and try and get it across to him and shoot it. So what we saw in the playoffs was when Pavelski went down and he wasn't on the power play, obviously, because he was hurt, they started switching to this strategy, and it started working. It was unreal to watch it because everyone knew it was coming. They knew the pass was going over to Burns. They still couldn't stop it. The goalie either couldn't – he would stop the puck, or he would either score or he'd stop the puck but give up a huge rebound.
Yeah.
He was never able to control it or freeze it or anything. So it works. I think what we're going to see is a lot of that with Timo Meier trying to clean up in front, probably just crashing the net after that one-timer gets across.
It's a hard shot to stop, and it's not just Burns' shot. Anytime you're the goaltender and you've got to slide from one post to another or just from being set and slide across, anytime you get the goalie moving, that's a really solid way to try to get the puck in the back of the net because the goalie wants to be set. He wants to have his angles correct. He doesn't want to have to be in flight trying to stop a puck. So getting those one-timers off, a really great strategy, something we talked about all last season right. that we wanted to see more of was Bernsey in that Ovechkin office, right? And, of course, Erik Karlsson feeding it to him would mm-hmm. would be ideal. But
there's a great breakdown, actually, on Kevin yeah. LeBanc on the power play and how elite he is. This is going back to the very end of last season, maybe even into the playoffs. Sheng Peng, is that his name?
Sheng Peng.
He did a breakdown of Kevin LeBanc and what he does on the power play. He has a very deceptive pass/shot, mm-hmm. where if his shot is not open, he will get the pass off across to the other side. And if it is open, he takes an elite shot. And I'll post this up there. Sorry, producer Jason, you're going to have to put this up there. He did a whole Twitter chain, and we'll get it up there just to kind of show it. But it really is a great breakdown of what he did and or what he does on the power play. And what I think that's going to do is he's always on the right side of the goal,
yeah.
and he has his right-hand shot, and he's either going to shoot it or pass it across to Ovechkin sitting
right,
there.
Right,
Burns waiting in the Ovechkin slot. Or looking for a tip for Timo Meier, or going back to the point to Karlsson. So I think our power play is going to be much better when you have those guys out there.
Yeah.
And changing the strategy from what it was.
Totally agree. I think our power play had some room for improvement anyway, and it has nothing to do with Pavs leaving and we're going to be better now. No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying the whole strategy around the power play being different. I think it'll be refreshing for fans to watch, obviously, and it'll be different for other teams to have to try to adjust to now, because I think other teams are kind of catching on to Burns is going to get the puck and he's going to wrist it over to Pavelski.
Totally.
Right? So I think it'll be good to have kind of a refresh, if you will, of the way that we go ahead and attack teams when it comes to the power play. So all good things there. Are we done with all the power play talk now? We're yep. good there? Okay, hey, one thing I wanted to talk about before we get to some of the other stuff. What's his name now? Finn, the Shark Pup, at right. Shark Pup, if you wanted to follow him on Twitter. So I had an opportunity to meet him just the other day. Actually, they called us up and said, would you guys like to come out and cover? So yes, absolutely we would. We'll throw some pictures that I took up. We'll roll some video maybe. I've got some interview stuff going on, a couple nice. Questions and whatnot. So we'll go ahead and play some of that stuff for you in just a second here. But take a look at this dog. He's absolutely adorable. we had some video where he's attacking Sharky. Essentially, he's kind of got his face inside of Sharky's mouth, and I assume he was licking him in there. I don't know, but it sure looked like Sharky was dead for a moment. But it was a great time out being able to see them, and the Canine Companion folks that are there, we'll put their link down below. They're a great organization. Mm-hmm. They truly want to help out San Jose and the folks that are in need here in the community. These dogs help out with PTSD. They help out with folks in wheelchairs and whatnot. I was asking about this actually, like, hey, can a guy like me get a dog like this? Because they change the channel for you if you need assistance with stuff like that. These dogs
and they
are
laughed and said no.
No, they said no. Yeah, no, they these dogs are born and bred to for service, mm-hmm. and they do a phenomenal job of that. This dog Finn is 11 weeks old and he knows how to do several commands. You should see the way he was staring at that treat bag yeah. on this lady's hip. By the way, I think her name was Sherry. The dog knew exactly what he was looking at. He was staring right at that treat bag. It was really good. So anyway, we'll roll a little bit of the audio from that and some of the video as well for you guys, so you can kind of check that out. But definitely check out these folks here, Canine Companions for Independence. Again, we'll put that link down below. So go ahead and enjoy the clip here.
I'm his volunteer puppy raiser, so I'll have him for about 18 months. And we'll work on about 30 commands and socialization and good house manners.
I see him already sitting on command. That's great.
We're working on that. That's where we start. And he then will go on to professional training. And then after that, hopefully be placed with somebody with disabilities as an assistance dog. So maybe helping somebody who's a wheelchair user. They can pick up things, turn on lights, open doors, close drawers, open the fridge. Wow. Or be a hearing dog to alert to sounds. He could work with children who have disabilities or autism. And then the last task, or two more tasks, could be with a professional who uses the dog in their job, like a speech therapist, in the police force, They can work with special ed teachers, and then we're just starting a program with PTSD veterans.
Okay.
So the dogs can do some specific tasks like nightmare interruption.
Right.
And then also provide kind of a safe space. The dog can stand in front or behind the veteran to give them a little bit of personal space.
I see.
And also the companionship and comfort and calming effects.
So the Sharks have always been very passionate, have always admired the passion that Canine Companions has for providing these assistance dogs to those who need them. And I think it just shows that how dedicated we are to those in the community and how we are always there to support in any way they need.
So again, really great organization. Check them out. Really, really adorable dog.
Really cute dog.
Oh my gosh, so cute. And I had my son was there too, and he was taking pictures and whatnot.
Did he want the dog?
He actually, yes, he did want the dog. Yeah, but sorry, buddy, not happening. And so we want to do a quick shout out to a fan of the show. Can I give a little backstory? You think he'd be okay with that?
Yeah.
Okay, well, there's a guy on Twitter. His name is Antone. He is moving in with his girlfriend. Congratulations.
Congrats, buddy.
That's awesome. And he has extra baubles now because they're both Sharks fans. They both have some of the same baubles. And so instead of having two of the same, he's decided to donate a few of them to the show, which is great. And we're going to be able to do giveaways with them. We've confirmed with him that that's okay. So more baubles for our fans.
Yeah.
So we'll go ahead and we'll just grab a couple because we have some of the other already here. But
right.
Go ahead.
We're going to add some of these. This is the Joe Thornton fighting bobble, where the tuft of hair that came out is missing and it's down there.
For those who don't know, there was the fight with Nazem Kadri, is what it was. And
he grabbed him and he ripped out, not on purpose, he was just grabbing him.
Grab here.
He tried to grab his jersey and he got a jersey and hair and then it came out and there was a big chunk on the ice afterwards.
Gross.
It was so gross. So they did that.
So there's that. And then this one here, which is a cool Logan Couture one. I like this one a lot. It's the celebration that he's doing.
Mm-hmm.
He's got the
similar
stick
to the video you got.
There. What's that?
It's similar to the video you got of them at practice last year.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah,
doing that celebration.
Yeah, that's true. So just really cool. Again, Antone, thank you so much.
We
appreciate that. Anybody else who has stuff like this that you guys want to donate to the show so that we can do giveaways for our fans?
Or just have on the set.
Yeah, that like this Mike Ricci stick right here was one that we got last season. It's signed by, it's not just Ricci. I think there's a bunch of guys in there.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're more than happy to take your free stuff. add it to our set, and then you know if you want us to do a giveaway with it, we absolutely will. If you don't want us to give it away, you want to give it back, we'll absolutely give it back. We even had someone last season who had given us jerseys that we were hanging up for a short while there until I guess maybe he ran out of jerseys. It was the jersey collector.
Sounds like a jersey collector.
There you go. So again, Antone, congratulations on moving in with your girlfriend. Lots of fun things to come after that, I suppose. And thank you again for the baubles and whatnot. We'll make sure that they have good homes for the time being and then good homes when we do another meetup. So again, thank you for that. Now, you've got something that you wanted to go ahead and let everybody know about.
We are going to do a fantasy hockey league, and I'm going to be running it. And I don't think Paul's going to have a team because he really doesn't enjoy doing fantasy, but I do.
Okay, stop you right there. I do, and I enjoy it. Don't get me wrong, I enjoy it.
So you'll have a team this year.
My problem is I focus in so hard. The one year that I did it, where it was not for money, so I had no reason to be as fanatical about it as I was. I like let it run my life. Okay, so I can't do it. I'm sorry, guys. I really wish I could, but I just can't. So
I don't know what the prize is going to be for the winners yet.
Right.
Maybe we'll do some merch or something.
Okay.
Something fun.
What if you
would want. I will donate it to the next place person.
There you go.
I don't need it.
How generous the show is.
Thanks. Hopefully I do win. But I'm going to be running it through Fantrax, which is kind of a newer site. Normally I use Yahoo, but I've been very interested in using Fantrax, so this is a perfect opportunity. I don't think a lot of people use it, so everyone will be in the same boat learning it. I'm going to set it up so it'll be head-to-head, pretty basic stuff. But anyway, if you're interested in joining, one of the benefits of Fantrax is it's open all year round. It doesn't close like Yahoo does. So we can do signups now and get everything ready. So we're looking for a 12-team league, so I'm going to be one team, so we need 11 teams to fill it out. If we have way more, then maybe I will consider doing a tiered system where we have two leagues, and if you win, you know, maybe the top three teams of one move up and the top bottom three move down, kind of like soccer relegation, because I love that.
Okay.
I wish more sports would do that.
Sure.
So anyway, and then in that case, if that's the case, then we'll just randomly pick who gets in what. So there's no fighting. I could even be in the second division. Who knows? So anyway, if you are interested, please email us at thefinfactor@gmail.com with your email, so I can send you the link. Or hit us up on Twitter DM or Instagram DM or some other way. Figure it out. So if you want it, if you're interested, please join and let me know.
Sounds fun to me. I wish I could do it, but it will run my life, so I will not. What I will do, though, is on September 13th, NHL 20 will be out for Xbox and PS4. Mm-hmm. We are hoping to get maybe Patrick. I don't know if he's going to be back in the fold tonight.
Sure.
I'm sure he will. So if Patrick, if you're listening, and I'm sure that you are because you're an avid fan, thank you for that. we might have Patrick start up the Xbox EASHL team. I know I'll be starting up the EASHL team for the PS4, and I'm going to give priority to the guys that are currently on the team, the ones that have been playing at least. The guys that aren't playing, you know who you are. actually, I've not been playing recently.
Neither have I.
Yeah, I know. So I think it kind of died off after a while there. But yeah, so the guys that were regulars, I'm going to give those guys priority. But we're going to go ahead and fill that team out. And as the season progresses, obviously we'll have some cycling in, cycling out. Really for me, and I'll say the same thing from last season, I just want to play with my Barbie Funhouse Arena. That's really what it comes down to. I just want you guys to play.
He likes customizing everything and creating the arena.
It looks awesome.
Jerseys and everything else.
Yeah. So
it's fun.
Give me the opportunity to do that. That's all I'm asking for. So September 13th, EASHL, that's when we're going to be probably kicking this whole thing off. That's when the game is released at least. So when I've got that going, you guys go ahead and get your copies and get ready to go. And we will start that up and it'll be fun.
Yep.
So, and we'll show screenshots of, you know, leaderboards and that kind of thing.
So for during this season of the Fin Factor, we're going to highlight both the Fantasy League for maybe a minute and then the EASHL for about a minute. So we'll have two little segments just to highlight it and give some screenshots and shout outs to the people who are playing.
Maybe if you guys do the recording, because I'm too lazy for it, maybe we'll do a goal of the week kind of thing.
Yeah,
which would be sweet, actually. Yeah. So
there's some really good goals.
Yeah, absolutely. So if you guys are
we don't score.
No, we don't score the really good goals. No, Zinxie's yes. Solid. Big Red. Yes.
Yeah,
I know you're watching, buddy.
Yeah.
So look out for that stuff, and if that's something that you guys would be interested in, we can absolutely tack that on to the end of the show. So. With all that being said, I think we've ran our course now.
Yes.
The end of this episode. One last thing, actually, I was really proud of it. It was the bowling pin. I showed this off during the live. I'm going to show it off right here as well. I just think it's really cool. We got this from a fan of the show. And again, I'm not giving this away, but if you have cool stuff like this that you want us to put on the show, even if you want it back, that's totally fine. We'll happily do that. Let us know, because I just think this is awesome. And by the way, if anybody has 9 more of these,
we'll get a fun game going.
Yeah, we'll get a good game going. All right. So that is going to do it for episode number 52. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. We do appreciate it. Also, remember to check out the lives, because the lives are so much fun. We're getting back into full effect with the live stuff going on. Mm-hmm. We had a huge hiatus after playoffs because we got burned on doing lives. But we're doing them again before the shows. We're putting those out on Twitter when we do go live. So if you guys are following us on Twitter at The Fin Factor, then you will get those notifications when we do. So with that being said, that is the end of episode 52. Thanks again for so much for tuning in. And we will see you guys
in a few weeks, I guess.
Yeah, probably a few weeks. Yeah, you're going to be gone.
I'll be gone.
Yeah, so he'll be gone for a couple weeks. Something happens, it'll be me and maybe Super Key Grip Joe, or maybe we'll have the return of Marshall.
No.
We'll see. No Marshall. Marshall. Anyway, thanks, guys. Tune in. See ya.
Bye.
Thanks for tuning in. If you like this episode, check out our other content, especially interviews. You can interact with us directly through social media at The Fin Factor and on Instagram at Fin Factor. And don't forget to join our live streams on YouTube.
Visit our website at thefinfactor.com, where you'll find all of our episodes as videos or podcasts. You'll also find our exclusive merchandise to help support our show.